Hello everyone and welcome to the next set of videos. Now in these videos we are discussing about the previous year GATE question paper solutions and we'll be discussing about the computer science question papers. And as you can see, the first question paper that we'll be discussing is GATE 2018 computer science and general aptitude paper. We'll be taking both aptitude as well as technical part here. And if you want to watch the videos lecture, obviously you are watching these video lectures on our YouTube channel, but if you want to take the PDF solutions, the PDF file of these solution of these question papers, then you can just go to the website, which is ankurgupta.net. As you can see, it is mentioned over here. Go to the website. In the question paper solution section, previous year paper solution section, you will find the solution of these GATE question papers, which is GATE 2018, 17, 16, so on. So we have created a video solution as well as the text solution of the last 10-15 years GATE computer science question papers. Now let us start with the first question in the GATE 2018. This is for the set 3. We will take all the questions one by one and I'll try to give the proper explanation of each and every question so that you'll be able to understand how we reached to the solution and how can you attempt the questions in the examination hall, because we are also trying to solve in such a way that we are solving the questions in for the very first time, as well as we'll try to make these questions understandable to everyone. So just watching these videos will actually help you in your examination preparation. So let us look at the first question. The first question says, from where are they bringing their books? Dash, bringing dash books from dash. So they are giving some fill in the blanks, I'm assuming. And they're asking the words that best fills the blank in the above sentence. So we have to take out the words in the options which is filling the blanks in the above sentence. Now let us look at the option. In the options, as I can see, they are only giving three words, theer, thare, and theyre, and there. So let us understand the difference between these three words first. So the first word is theer. Now what is a there? So this is also called as there, as well as if I say THERE, both these two words are called as there, but there's a basic difference between these two words. When I say THERE, now this THERE is used to point towards places. So I can say it is used for places. Can you put your book over there? So that means when I'm saying THERE, so can you put your book over there? Now in that sentence, I use THERE because this is pointing towards a place. Now when I'm using their, now this their is used for pointing towards people. It is used for pointing people. For example, I can say parents are keen to help their children, right? Then in that sentence, I'm using their. The sentence says parents keen to help their children. Now in that sentence I'm using their because this is pointing towards people. Can you put your book over there? In that case I'm using there because this is pointing towards place. And the third is they are, theyr, they are. Now they are is actually used for pointing towards a group. It is used for pointing towards a group. Okay, now let us say I'm saying they are happy. Now here I'm pointing towards a group of people. Now this group can be anything. It can be a group of people, it can be a group of animals, it can be a group of substances or something like that. Now, whenever you are pointing towards a group, then you are using they are. Now let us take all these sentences one by one. So the first sentence, when we use the first option number A, it will be from where are they bringing their books. If I using there here and they are here and they are here, then what happens? So they are bringing their books from there. Now this is completely wrong because here they are bringing is wrong because it is used to point to people, but they are specifying something else. So this is completely wrong. And this is when I'm saying they are. Now they are means it's a group. We are pointing towards a group. Now this is also completely wrong, but this one is correct. So these two point positions are wrong. When I'm using the second option says this was the first option. Okay. And the second option says that we have to use they are here, they are, they are, T-H-E-I-R. The last one we have to use T-H-E-R-E. So when I'm saying they are bringing, so this is perfectly correct because they are bringing, it's a group of people, they are bringing their books. It is pointing towards those people, right? It is pointing towards those people, pointing towards those people who are bringing the books from there, where it is pointing towards a place, it is pointing towards a place, okay, and it is pointing towards a group of people. When I'm saying T-H-E-Y-R-E, so it is group of people, right? So it is a group of people who are bringing their books, I mean their books from there, where there is a place. And this option number B is completely and thoroughly matching. In the same way, you can check the option number C and option number D. You can see that option number C and D, they might not be matching with the answers here. I hope that you understood the solution. And the solution to this problem is option number B. If you face any difficulty regarding the solution, then you can just email me at admin@gatelectures.com. I'll try to sort out your queries, or the best way is just comment on this video and I'll try to see if I can solve your problems in the comments itself. Now let us look at the next sentence. Here they are saying a dash investigation can sometimes yield new facts, but typically organized ones are more successful. What does he want to say if I translate the same sentence in Hindi? A dash investigation can sometimes new facts. एक इन्वेस्टिगेशन है जो कभी कभी नए फैक्ट्स को यील्ड कर सकता है बट हियर दिस वर्ड बट इज इंपॉर्टेंट बट टिपिकली द ऑर्गेनाइज्ड वंस आर मोर सक्सेसफुल व्हेन दे आर सेइंग लेकिन अगर हमारे पास कुछ इन्वेस्टिगेशन है जो कि ऑर्गेनाइज्ड है तो वो इन्वेस्टिगेशन ज्यादा सक्सेसफुल होती हैं या फिर वो इन्वेस्टिगेशन ज्यादा सक्सेसफुल होंगी राइट अगर ऑर्गेनाइज जो इन्वेस्टिगेशन हैं वो ज्यादा सक्सेसफुल होती हैं तो यहां पर जो पहला सेंटेंस है मोस्ट प्रोबेबली वो एक अनऑर्गेनाइज्ड इन्वेस्टिगेशन के बारे में डिस्कस कर रहा है ओके ये जब चीजें हैं ये मैंने अभी ऑप्शंस नहीं देखे लेकिन ये सिर्फ मैं सेंटेंस से इन्फर करने की कोशिश कर रहा हूं आई एम जस्ट ट्राइंग टू इन्फर द सेम दीज थिंग फ्रॉम दिस सेंटेंस इटसेल्फ दैट इन द सेकेंड पार्ट दे आर सेइंग दैट ओनली ऑर्गेनाइज्ड इन्वेस्टिगेशन कैन यील्ड सॉरी आई एम सेइंग इन सेकेंड पार्ट दे आर सेइंग दैट ऑर्गेनाइज्ड इन्वेस्टिगेशन आर मोर सक्सेसफुल But that does not mean that unorganized are not successful. But still in an unorganized investigation can also yield some new facts. It can be there. But let us see the fill in the blanks here. Meandering. Okay, so let us just see the word meaning of the other three words. Then we'll come back to the meandering word. When I'm saying timely, consistent and systematic. Now, timely, consistent and systematic, both all these three things are actually a part of organized investigation because the organized investigations are timely, they are consistent as well as they are systematic. But when I'm saying the word meandering, now this meandering has a meaning. The meaning of the meandering is an act of following winding course, an act of following winding course and I can also define meandering in one more way it is the proceedings in a convoluted or undirected fashions it is proceedings in a convoluted or undirected fashion So when I'm saying it is undirected, that means it is clearly saying it is unorganized. It is unorganized. Okay. So that means a meandering investigation, I can say a meandering investigation can sometimes yield new facts. That means an unorganized investigation can sometimes yield new facts. But typically, organized ones are more successful. So the answer to this question is option number A, because option number A is the best matching according to what this sentence is trying to say. Now let us look at the next question, and this question is from mathematics. I'll say it is from geometry. The question says, the area of a square is D. What is the area of a circle which has the diagonal of the square as its diameter? Understand this, diagonal of the square, diagonal of the square as the diameter of the circle. What does it mean? It means that, assuming that we have a square like this, now the area of the square, area of square is D. Okay, and what is the formula of the area of the square? Formula is side into side, that means side square. That means that if the area of the square is D, that means the side of the square, every side, like this is a side, every side of the square will be under root of D. That means in the same, in this given square, this side is under root of D, this side is under root of D, this side is under root of D, and this side is under root of D. That means every side is under root of D. Now read the question again. They are saying the diagonal of the square. They are asking the diagonal of the square. So what is the diagonal? This will be the diagonal of the square. And what is this diagonal? For finding this diagonal, we can just use the hypotenuse theorem, which says hypotenuse of a square will be equal to base square plus height or altitude square. Where here base and altitude we already know. So hypotenuse, I mean this diagonal. So this diagonal will be under root of base square plus altitude square, where base square is under root D, plus altitude square is also under root D. Okay, so square of these two. So this will be under root of 2D. So that is, this diagonal of the square will be under root of 2D, because that is the hypotenuse, the length of the hypotenuse. Okay, or you can say the diagonal of the square. Now in the second part, they are saying that we have a circle here. Now in this circle, there will be a diameter, and the length of this diameter from here to here, this length will be equal to the length of this diagonal of the square. So that means this length of the diagonal will be under root of 2D. Now they are asking, what should be the area of the circle? And we know the formula for the area of the circle. Area of circle can be calculated as pi r square. But remember, here it is r square. But if I say, if I convert this r square in the form of diameter, then it will be pi d divided by 2 square. That means radius is half of the diameter. And we know the diameter here. We just try to put this value in here. So it will be pi under root of 2d divided by 2 whole square, which can be written as pi 2d divided by 4. We can cancel it like this. So it will be pi d divided by 2. So pi d divided by 2, that will be called as the area of this circle, which is pi d by 2. So in the option, the first option is pi d, which is wrong. The second option is pi d square, which is also wrong, because they are asking what is the area of the circle. Third option is also wrong. The fourth option is correct. In the fourth option, they are saying it is 1 by 2 pi d. So this can also be written as 1 by 2 into pi d, which is the correct answer for this given question. Okay. I hope that you understood this question very well. And if you face any difficulty, just let me know in the comments. Let us look at the next question. They are saying, what would be the smallest natural number which, when divided either by 20 or by 42 or by 76, leaves a remainder of 7 in each case? Now they are saying the smallest natural number, if we divide that number by all these three, that is 20, 42 and 76, it should leave a remainder 7. Now remember one thing, for this question there are two parts. Number one, find a smallest number that can be divided by 20, 42 and 76. Okay. Now, if you can find the smallest number that can be divided by all these three, and then we want a remainder as 7, for that, to that smallest number, if I add a number 7, now that number 7 can yield a new number, which when divided by any one of these three, or you can say which one divided by these three, it can yield a remainder as 7. Now, can you find the smallest number that can be divided by all three of this? Yes. How can you find it? For this, you have to use the concept of LCM, that is lowest common multiplier. So, find the LCM of all these three numbers, which is 20, 42 and 76. You know the method. I am just not calculating it just to save the time, because I have already calculated the remainder of 20, 42 and 76. So, the remainder will be 7980, that is 7980. The second part of this question is, to this remainder, which is 7980, just add the number 7. So it will be 7987. And which 7987? The first option is wrong, second option is wrong, third option is 7987, which is perfectly correct, and the fourth option is also wrong. So the answer to this question is 7987, which is the option number C. Right? So that's so easy, guys. Right? I hope that you properly understood the concept here. Now let us look at this next question. Now in the next question, they are saying, what is the missing number in the following sequence? Now if you see the sequence is like this: 2, 12, 60, 240, 720, 1140, dash and 0. Now guys, this sequence is, you can see quite, it can be quite difficult to find the next sequence, but just see that how these numbers are increasing. These numbers are actually increasing exponentially. That means every time whenever we go to the next number, it becomes more difficult to calculate what is the next sequence. Okay, so first number is 2, next is 12, 60, 240, 720, 1140. Now what I'll do is, I'll take from the second part, I'm not taking the first part, just because from here it is increasing more frequently, or you can say more exponentially. So from in this 2, if you add 2 multiplied by 6, then you are going to get 12, right? I'm just assuming it. Okay, I don't know if it is valid or not, I'm just assuming it. In this 12, if I add 12 multiplied by 5, then we are going to get 60. In this 60, if I add 60 multiplied by 4, then we are going to get 240. In this 240, if I multiply 240 multiplied by, let us say 3, so if I calculate it will be 720. If I multiply it by 720 multiplied by 2, that will be 111440. Okay, that means every time I am multiplying these numbers by 6, 2 multiplied by 6, 12 multiplied by 5, 60 multiplied by 4, 240 multiplied by 3, 720 multiplied by 2, that is 2 multiplied by 6, 12 multiplied by 5, 60 multiplied by 4, 240 multiplied by 3, 720 multiplied by 2, then next number will be 1440 multiplied by 1. Okay, and after that the next number will be 1440 multiplied by 0. Whatever the outcome of this will, that will be multiplied by 0. Okay, so the answer to this question is this one, because if you multiply 1440 by 1, then we will get this fill the blanks, which is 1440. Hence, on these options, we have option number B, which is the correct option, which is 1440. I hope that you understood the question and the solution of the question. Now let us look at the next question here. Next question says, in appreciation of the social improvements completed in a town, a wealthy philanthropist decided to gift rupees 750 to each male citizen. So that means if we have male citizens, then we will be gifting 750 rupees. and rupees 1000 to each female citizen, that is they are giving it to senior citizens. Okay, senior citizens. Okay, although there are 300 senior citizens eligible to this gift, so total senior citizens are 300. Total senior citizens are 300. Okay, so we can have male senior citizen plus female senior citizen, that will be total of 300. Fine. And to every male citizen we are gifting 750 rupees, and to every female senior citizen we are giving 1000 rupees. However, only 8/9 of the eligible men, 8/9 of the eligible men, that means total number of men, whatever number of men will be, only 8/9 of the eligible men and 2/3 of the eligible women claimed the gift. That means 2/3 of total women, they claimed the gift. Then how much money did the philanthropist give away? That means this is the total number of male and this is the total number of female who attended. Okay, and to every male we are gifting 750 rupees. That means this is these many people attended, multiplied by this many this much money per people, and these many women attended, multiplied by this much money per women. So this much total money is spent. This is the total amount of money. This is total money that is spent. Okay, and we need to find out these values. So just to find out these values, just insert these values. If we know that male plus female is equal to 300. Okay, total male plus female is equal to 300. Okay, now you can see between both of them, I mean take this option between this entire sentence, can we try and reduce the values here? Just try to see if we can try and reduce the values. If I say 8 multiplied by 750 divided by 9, okay, the first will be 8 multiplied by 750 divided by 9. So what will be this value? I already calculated it. This value will be 2000 males divided by 3. It will be 2000 males divided by 3. Just calculate this value. So I have already calculated it before, but for your simplicity you can calculate this value, and this will be 2000 female, or 2000 women divided by 3. From this value and this value we can take 2000 by 3 as common. So it will be male plus women, that is men plus women, and we already know this value. This is men plus women, and this value will be a total of 300 that we already know. So this is a total of 300. Okay, now if you calculate this, that is 3 and 300 divide, if you divide both these two numbers, it will be 100. So then the solution will be 100 divided by 2000, which will be a total of 2 lakhs. So the solution will be option number B, which is 2 lakhs. Okay. Guys, how I'm solving this and how I'm calculating the values, because I have already solved this problem before, and I already know if I multiply 750 multiplied by 8/9, this it will be 2000 divided by 3. So it will be 2000 divided by 3 men. In the same way, if I divide 2/3 women multiplied by 1000, it will be 2000 women divided by 3. So I already calculated these two values. Now I'm just taking 2/3 as common, or 2000 by 3 as common here. And because I already know the values of men plus women, that is why I solved this problem so easily. But if you are solving this problem in examination hall step by step, obviously a calculator is available to you. Now because there's a calculator is available to you in the examination hall, so you don't have to perform these calculations difficulty. I mean, so you already know that if a calculator is available, then you can easily solve this problem by using that calculator. Okay, I hope that you understood this problem very well. Now let us look at the next problem, because now we are discussing all the problems which are of 2 marks, which is question number 6 to 10, they carry 2 marks problem. Okay. Now let us look at the question number 7. The question number 7 saying, if PQR is not equal to 0 and P raised to power minus X is 1 by Q, Q raised to power minus Y is 1 by R, and R raised to power minus Z is equal to 1 by P. What is the value of the product x, y, z? So they are asking what is the value of x and y multiplied by z. Now because we know the value of p, so p will be minus x p raised to power minus x is equal to 1 by q. From here we can find out the value of x. From here we can find out the value of y. And from here we can find out the value of z. Now for this we need some properties of logarithms. Let us solve them step by step, and accordingly I'll also explain the properties. Take log on both sides. So it will be log of p raised to power minus x is equal to log of 1 by q. Now again here there's a property of logarithm that can be applied. So it can be written as minus x log p is equal to, again here there's one more property that can be applied, that is log 1 minus log q. So this is a property of logarithm. Now it can be written as log 1 can be written as 0. So hence it can be written as minus x log p is equal to minus log q, which can be written as x is equal to log q divided by log p. So this is the first part. In the same way, find the value of q also. So q can be written as q raised to power minus y can be written as 1 by r. Take log on both sides. So it will be minus y log q is equal to log 1 minus log r. Further, it can be written as y is equal to log r divided by log q. In the same way, the third one is r raised to power minus z, which is equal to 1 by p. Now, take log on both sides, then we'll get z is equal to log p divided by log r. So we know the values of x, y and z. So the value of x is this much, the value of y is this much, and the value of z is this much. We know the value of x, y and z. So now we have to multiply x multiplied by y multiplied by z. That is what we needed to find out. So just substitute their values. X is log q multiplied by log p. Y is log r multiplied by log q. And z is log p multiplied by log r. Now here you can see there are some values are we can eliminate. Log p and log p, they can be cancelled. Log q and log q, they can be cancelled. And log r, they can be cancelled. So after cancellation, we get x multiplied by y multiplied by z is equal to 1. So x, y, z is equal to 1. So this is the solution to this problem. So option number A is wrong, option number B is wrong, option number C is right, and option number D is wrong. So I hope that you understood this easily. Now let us move on to the next question here. So next question says, in a party, 60% of the invited guests are male, 40% are female. So total 60% of the guests are male, 40% of the guests are female. If 80% of the invited guests attended the party, so whatever the number of male and female were there, so 80% of total guests, 80% of the total guest attended the party. Okay, 80% of the guests attended the party. If all the invited female guests attended, that means all the females attended the party, then what would be the ratio of males to females among the attendees in the party? They are asking what is the ratio of males to females. Okay, now guys, here you can clearly see that they have not given what is the total number of guests. We don't know this value. They have not even given what is the people who attended the parties. They are just given that, I mean, they are just given us the percentage. Okay, now there are two ways. Number one is we can take some sample space, that is sample data. For example, the total guest can be assuming 100, and then we can find out the solution. And second is, instead of taking the total guest as 100, just take total guest as x. Okay, assuming the total guest as x. So let us solve in both the ways. If the total guests, total people, so total guests and total people will be 100, then 60% of them are males. That means there will be 60 males and there will be 40 females. There will be 40 females. Okay, fine. So in the same way, if your total guests are x, that means there will be 60x divided by 100 are male and 40x divided by 100 are females. These many males and these many females. There they are saying only 80% attended the party. Only 80% attended the party. That means out of these 100, only 80 people attended the party. In the same way, because only 80% attended, that means out of these x, only 80x divided by 100 people attended the party. Okay. Now the next phase is, they are saying that all the invited female guests attended the party. All the female guests attended the party. No females left out. So all the 40 females attended the party. Right. So we know that people who attended the party, total are 80. Out of these 80, 40 are females. So rest people are the male people. Okay. So it will be a total of 40 males who attended the party. Who attended the party. Okay. In the same way, here also, you can see this 80x divided by 100 are the total people who attended the party. Out of these, all the females attended, that is 40x divided by 100 are the females who attended the party. Then rest remaining will be the males who attended the party. And from here, you can calculate, it will be 40x divided by 100 males who attended the party. Now they are asking what would be the ratio of males to female among the attendees of the party. Ratio of males to females. Okay. So because here 40 females attended and 40 males attended. So hence the ratio will be 1:1. Okay. In the same way here also you can see 40x females and 40x females. So ratio will be 1:1. So because the same number of males and females attended the party, hence the answer is option number B for this given question. Option number A, C and D, all these are wrong. I hope that you understood the solution pretty well. So guys, let us look at the next question. In this question, they are saying angle DEC and angle BFC is equal to which of the following? In this given triangle, they are asking what is angle DEC. So DEC, this angle is, let us assume it is X. So they are asking what is this angle plus angle BFC. So what is the sum of this angle? So assuming this angle is A, this is Y, this is angle Z, and this is angle B. Okay, so they are asking what is angle X plus angle A. Okay, so the angle X plus angle A. And they are giving some options. So first option is angle BCD. BCD. BCD is they're asking it is equal to angle Z minus BAD, which is angle B. Angle Z minus angle B. Second option is saying BAD plus BFC, BAD, BAD, that is angle B, plus BCF, BCF is angle BCF, okay, I'm not given it, so let us say it is angle C, then BAD, BAD is angle B, and BCD is angle C, so the BCD is angle Z. And the third option CBA, 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 this angle, assume it is angle D small d, so it is angle small d, plus ADC, ADC, assume it is small f, so it is f. Okay, they are asking angle X plus angle A, what will be the value of angle X plus angle A. Now we know the property of a triangle, that if you have a triangle like this, if this is A, B, C, this angle X, this angle Y, and this angle Z. Then we know that angle Z is equal to angle X plus angle Y. There's a property of a triangle that sum of two interior angles will be equal to this exterior angle. Or you can say the exterior angle of a triangle is sum of two opposite interior angles. Okay, it's a very easy property of a triangle. Now let us try to find out all these angles. The same way we can find out this value of Z. Remember, most of the things are not given. For this Z, it can be written as angle X plus angle Y. Okay. And in the same way, we can find out what is the value of angle Y. So angle Y can be written as angle A plus angle B. Okay. We know the value of angle Z. We know the value of angle Y. Correct? That's so easy, guys. Now, this angle Z we know, and we need to find, I can say, correct. So here, from here, I can say that angle Z, this is angle Y, is equal to angle A plus angle B. And I can say angle Z is equal to angle X plus angle Y. Correct? These are two values that we got from here. Now, we know that angle Z can also be written as angle X plus angle A plus angle B, because I'm just substituting this value of Y in here. So after substituting this value Y, we know that angle Z can also be written as angle BCD. Angle BCD, this is angle Z, which is angle BCD, the first value here. And there is angle Z. And we know that angle B, because here I'm just checking the options, because here angle B can be written as BAD, that is angle B. So we know angle Z and angle B. I'm taking the help of options also. So by this, I can just take this B here on this side. So we can say angle Z minus angle B is equal to angle X plus angle A. Okay. And this angle X is angle DEC. It is angle DEC. And angle A is BFC. Okay. I'm just using these values. So this is given like this. Therefore, I can say these two angles are actually equal to angle Z minus angle B, which is the option number A, which is the correct answer to this given question. I just have to substitute the values, guys. It was easy, but to solve this problem, you should know what is the properties of a triangle. So here, the property that came into play is the exterior angle property. Correct? I hope that you understood this problem. Now let us look at the next question. They are saying, a six-sided unbiased die with four green faces and two red faces. We have a die. Okay, so die looks something like this, which is in a form of a cube, where we have four green faces and two red faces. It's rolled seven times. Okay, which of the following combination is most likely outcome of the experiment? Okay. Now guys, here they are giving out probability and it is experiment. Now remember one thing, we have only two possible outcomes of the die. Okay, either we can get a red face or we can get a green face. Okay. Now, whenever there's for any experiment, if there are only two possible outcomes that can be there for any experiment, in that case, we use binomial theorem. So, what is the binomial theorem? It says if we have NCR, that is, can be written as PCS raised to power R, and PCF raised to power n minus r, where when I'm saying r is the probability of the outcome. I mean, for example, here the first case they are saying three green faces and four red faces. What is the probability that we are getting three green faces and four red faces? Here the n is the total number of experiments, where total number of experiment can be seven. What is the probability that we can get three green faces? That will be given an r. Therefore, if there are three green faces, obviously, if I do 7 minus R, that can be written as 7 minus 3, which is 4. That is the probability of the four cases. There's the probability of the first outcome and the probability of the second outcome. Okay, where R is the first outcome that we are getting, and N minus R is the second number of second times the second outcomes that we are getting. Okay, this is a simple formula of a binomial theorem. You can just go and check out the binomial theorem. It is only applicable in the questions where we have only two possible outcomes. So easy. And binomial theorem can also be converted to a Bernoulli's theorem. Okay. Now they are saying which of the following combination is more likely to outcome of the experiment. The first question option is saying three green faces and four red faces. What is the probability of this? For option A, the probability of getting three green face and four red face, just apply this binomial theorem for this. So the probability will be 7C3, where 3 green faces, and we have 4 by 6 raised to power 4 and 2 red faces, that is 2 by 6 raised to power 3. Okay, so why I'm saying this is 4 by 6? Why it is 4 by 6? Because there are 4, you can see 4 green faces given. And why it is 2? Because there are 2 red faces in the original die. So the total, we have 6 faces. Out of these 6 faces, 4 are green and 2 are red. So this is the total number of faces, where 4 are green and 2 are red. Total number of faces, 4 are green and 2 are red. This is the probability for the first outcome. Okay, for B, option number B, it can be the probability for 4 green faces and 3 red faces. That can be written as 7C4 into 4 by 6 raised to power 4 into 2 by 6 raised to power 3. For third case, probability for 5 green faces and 2 red faces. So it is 7C5, 4 by 6 raised to power 5 into 2 by 6 raised to power 2. In the same way, probability of 6 green faces and 1 red face will be 7, 6, 6 into 4 by 6 raised to power 6 plus, let me just change the color of the pen, plus 2 by 6 raised to power 1. Out of these three values, you can calculate these values and you can find out which value is greatest, which outcome is greatest. Obviously, you can see 4 by 6 can be written as 4 by 6 can be written as 2 by 3 and 2 by 6 can be written as 1 by 3. So this 2 by 3 is greater than 1 by 3. So the first option, we have this 4 by 6 and 2 by 3. Okay, and you have 7C3. Calculate these values, find out which one is greater. Calculate this value and find out what is the value. Calculate this value and find out what is the value. And calculate this value and find out what is the value. Out of these four calculations, you can find out which one is the greatest. That is the answer to this given question. Okay, this is the one way of solving. And second way of solving is that you find the ratios between all of them and find the biggest ratio. Like for example, here, this is for A, this is for B, this is for C, this is for D. We can find A ratio B. We can find whatever the outcome is. Okay, if I calculate the outcome, then it will be B. Then we can find B ratio C. Whatever the outcome is, we can find the biggest outcome with other ratio. Okay. So because I have less space, so I'm not calculating it. But the simplest method is, you don't have to think more about it. Just calculate these values, find out which one is the biggest. I already calculated these values. And the biggest value that I am getting from here is option number C, which is having 5 green faces and 2 red faces. This is the most favorable outcome. This is the most favorable outcome. Okay, guys, why I'm not calculating these values? Because I don't have a calculator here. Okay, in examination hall, you'll be having calculator and you can solve these values. Correct? Now, in the next video, we'll be taking the technical questions. First, we'll be discussing the first 25 technical questions, which are of 1 marks. And then we'll be discussing the first, all the 2 marks technical questions. I hope that you enjoyed this video thoroughly and I hope this video was helpful for you. You can download the PDF solution of this video from the website, which is ankurgupta.net, and you can also visit gatelectures.com and subscribe to the YouTube channel. Sign up on gatelectures.com to find more interesting questions for your exam preparation, more interesting videos for your exam preparation. And thank you so much for watching. All the best.